Hi friends, hello, welcome to Let's Crack UPSC CSE with India's largest online learning platform. This is Kiran Anishetty, Faculty for Political Science, Polity, Issues in Governance, Public Administration and Ethics. I have done my MBA from Usmania University, MA in Political Science and Public Administration. I have a UGC NET in both Political Science and Public Administration. I have taken Civils Prelims exam for 7 times. 4 times I wrote my Civils Mains. Each time I scored more than 55% in Public Administration option. I have 10 plus years of UPSC teaching experience. I have taught in reputed institutions such as Telangana STIS Study Circle, Telangana Minority IAS Study Circle, Super 60 IAS Academy, Narayana IAS Academy, etc. If you have any queries, doubts, clarifications, or if you want my guidance or mentorship, you please call me on this number 9652583905. Friends, today we are going to discuss a very important topic. In previous session, we discussed the Office of the Governor Part 1. Today, we are going to discuss the Office of the Governor Part 2, which is very, very important from both prelims as well as mains point of view. You will get from an academy daily live classes, live tests, quizzes, structured courses, unlimited access to videos on UPSC prelims and mains. You can prepare with the top educators of an academy such as Mrunal Patel, Roman Saini, Kash Kumar. You will be getting course material and videos on UPSC mains and prelims on subjects such as governance, ethics, CSAT, issues in governance, essay writing, modern India, etc. I suggest you to subscribe an academy. For 1 year, it will be 44,000. If you use my promo code, that is capital K-I-R-A-N, you will get 10% discount. You go for 24 months, it will be all the more good, because just for 64,000, you will be getting 24 months subscription. In this also, you will get 10% discount if you use my promo code, that is capital K-I-R-A-N. An academy has come up recently with iconic subscription, which comprises novel and frequent features such as personal mentorship, personal feedback, daily mains question and answers practice, unlimited practice on tests. I suggest this subscription. Through this subscription, you can get my guidance, mentorship, and personalized feedback on many subjects such as political science optional, public administration optional, entire paper 2, that is polity, Indian polity, constitution, issues in governance, international relations, and ethics. For 12 months, it will be 57,600. In this also, if you use my promo code, that is capital K-I-R-A-N, you will get 10% discount. For 24 months, it will be 89,100. In this also, you will get 10% discount if you use my promo code. In this session, we will discuss very, very important functions of governor. Discretionary powers of the governor. Article 163, it says, there shall be council of ministers headed by minister to aid and advise the governor, who acts in accordance with such advice, except in those circumstances in which he needs to act in his discretion according to the cause. Except in those circumstances in which he needs to act in his discretion according to the cause. Here, friends, we tend to make a mistake. We tend to draw analogy between the president and governor with regard to their respective discretionary functions. Because both at the center and state, we have parliamentary form of government. Parliamentary form of government is characterized by presence of dual executive, nominal executive and real executive. Nominal executive is president at center level, and the real executive is council of ministers headed by prime minister. At state level, the governor is nominal executive and the real executive is council of ministers headed by chief minister. Hence, we think that the way the president has a limited number of constitutional discretionary powers, in the same way, the governor of a state also has limited number of constitutional discretionary powers. No, this is where UPSC lays the catch. We should not make that, what you say, mistake. We should not have that misconception. It is clearly evident from the fact how the terminology is used in Article 74 and the terminology that is used in Article 163, Provision 1. What does Article 74 say? There shall be Council of Ministers headed by the President to aid and advise, there shall be Council of Ministers headed by Prime Minister to aid and advise the President. Who shall act in accordance with such advice? Remember the word shall. There shall be Council of Ministers headed by Prime Minister to aid and advise the President. Who shall act in accordance with such advice? Shall means what? President ought to act according to the advice tendered by Council of Ministers headed by Prime. Of course, the word shall has been incorporated by 42nd Amendment Act by Indira Gandhi government. On the other hand, if you analyze Article 163, Provision 1, article says, there shall be Council of Ministers headed by the Chief Minister to aid and advise the governor. Who acts in accordance with such advice? Except in those circumstances in which he needs to act in his discretion according to the cause. Who acts in accordance with such advice, except in those circumstances in which he needs to act in his discretion according to the cause. According to the cause. That means that there shall be Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister to aid and advise the governor. Who acts in accordance with such advice? But except in those circumstances in which he needs to act in his discretion according to the Constitution. This is where we have to read the provision 1 of Article 163 along with the provision 2 of Article 163. What is that? It is in governor's discretion in which circumstances he needs to act in his discretion according to the Constitution. What are those circumstances according to the Constitution in which governor needs to act in his pure discretion? Will be purely according to his own personal judgment. What ought to be what ought not to be done in his discretion cannot be questioned. That means Article 163 Provision 1 and Article 163 Provision 2 have bestowed tremendous discretionary powers on the government. Tremendous discretion is not just restricted to nominal head function because of the given the fact of these two provisions of the Constitution. That's why the second Commission on Center-State Relations, M.M. Poonchi Commission, recommended that the enormous discretionary powers of the governor should be curtailed. So these two provisions bestow tremendous discretionary powers on the governor. Hence, we should not think that the way the president has limited constitutional discretionary powers, in the same way, the governor also has limited constitutional discretion. Most of us, we have this mistaken belief that the president does not have any discretionary powers. No, he does have discretionary, constitutional discretionary powers, but they are limited. What are they? We discussed when we discussed the office of the president, and in my 10 minutes videos, I have dedicated one video specifically for this, the discretionary, constitutional discretionary powers of the president. Friends, always keep these two articles in your mind. The other day, yesterday, the governor of Rajasthan, he refused to convene the sessions of assembly to prove the strength of Ashok Gehlot government in Rajasthan State Legislative Assembly. Hence, his decision came into question today in many newspapers. There were so many articles regarding this. But such kind of decisions of the governor in earlier instances also have been questioned. For instance, in Arunachal Pradesh, when governor, without the advice of Council of Ministers, summoned the sessions of the assembly, and the governor himself appointed a speaker to conduct the sessions of assembly. At that time, the government of the day was lacking proper strength in the legislative assembly of Arunachal Pradesh, and it was avoiding the sessions of assembly. In that instance, he summoned the assembly sessions in Arunachal Pradesh. The case went to Supreme Court. Then Attorney General Mukul Rohtagi, he quoted only two articles from the Constitution. These are Article 163, Article 361. According to Article 163, Provision 1 and Provision 2, the governor has tremendous discretionary powers. As we discussed just now. And what does Article 361 say? The governor and president are not answerable to any court of law for the performance of their duties and functions. Governor and president are not answerable to any court of law for the performance of their duties and functions. This is how the governor of the state wields tremendous discretionary power. Now we are proceeding with other discretionary powers of the governor. After discussing the discretionary powers of the governor at the end of this session, we will discuss what could be the reason that our constitutional forefathers have bestowed tremendous discretionary powers on governor. We will discuss till the office of the governor is relevant and justify our answer with, what you say, reasons. Article 200. The governor can reserve state bills for the consideration of the president. Yesterday, in our last session, the part one session on the office of the governor, we discussed this discretionary power of the governor. The governor can reserve any state bill for the consideration of the president. It may be ordinary bill or money bill. And the president has absolute veto power over the state bills that have been reserved by the governor. Hence, if the governor wants, by utilizing Article 200, he can virtually relegate democratically elected legislative assembly defunct. He can make the duly elected legislative assembly to sink in atrophy. This is the significance of this Article 200. During UPA 1 and UPA 2 governments, in many instances, this particular article was misutilized. And many such bills, such state bills, were reserved by the governor for the consideration of the president. What will happen if governor utilizes this article? Three things we need to remember here. First, the president has absolute veto powers over the state bills that have been reserved by the governor. The president of India has absolute veto powers over only two bills. First, private member bill that has been raised in parliament. Then the other is a state bill that has been reserved by the governor under Article 200. Absolute veto means he can summarily reject the bill. Even money bills, state money bills that have been reserved by the governor under Article 200 can also be rejected by the president. Of course, he cannot send state money bills that have been reserved by the governor for reconsideration, but he can summarily reject those bills. In our previous session on governor part one, we were discussing in Andhra, there has been hue and cry with regard to three capitals: executive capital, legislative capital, judicial capital. If central government is really interested in preventing that, the governor of Andhra Pradesh, if he reserves the CRDA bill under Article 200 for the consideration of the president, it is the end of that bill. The president has absolute veto powers over the state bills that have been reserved by the governor. Second, there is no time limit mentioned in the constitution within which president has to convey his decision, whether he is accepting or rejecting. There is no time limit mentioned in the constitution within which the president has to convey his decision. Third, if the president rejects the state bill that has been reserved by the governor of the state concerned, the president need not to state the reasons for rejection of the bill. He need not to state the reason. Because of these three provisions, the governor and the president together can totally render the state legislative assembly defunct. I don't want to mention the name, but one of our former president, when that particular individual discharged functions as governor, there were many instances of such misutilization of this Article 200. So this is the significance of Article 200. You can understand the tremendous discretionary powers that have been wielded by the governor. This feature of the constitution we adopted from Canadian constitution, but in Canada, the president he can directly take for his consideration without the reservation of the governor. Without the interference of the governor, the president, directly he can take the state bill for his consideration, which is pending in front of state legislature. President means there, the nominal executive, the nomenclature may be different. Then, Article 160, the president can entrust the functions that are not mentioned in the Constitution. In this regard also, the governor has tremendous discretionary power. Governor will be acting as pure discretion as far as the functions that have been bestowed by the president on the governor. Article 160, under Article 160, the president can entrust the functions on the governor that are not mentioned in the Constitution. So, with regard to these functions, governor acts in his discretion, not on the advice tendered by Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister. Then Article 356, Provision 1, sending reports to the center with regard to the functions of constitutional machinery in the state. Article 356 relates to imposition of president rule in the state. The governor of the state has authority to send report to the center with regard to the functioning of constitutional machinery in the state. Here also, he need not to act on the advice of Council of Ministers. He acts in his pure discretion. Then under Article 239, Provision 2, functioning as an administrator of adjoining union territory. Functioning as an administrator of adjoining union territory. For instance, the governor of Tamil Nadu, if he is to be entrusted upon the functions as the administrator of adjoining union territory, that is Puducherry, with regard to those functions, the governor of Tamil Nadu need not to act on the advice of Council of Ministers headed by Tamil Nadu Chief Minister. He will be functioning in his discretion. Then Article 167, Provision 1. Article 167 has three provisions. Similar powers and functions are there on the part of the President under Article 78. These provisions of the Constitution, they bestow tremendous discretionary powers on the Governor. Telangana Governor, Tamilasai Soundararajan, he has been using these provisions in recent times, in most of the instances. He sought a report with regard to Port Transport Corporation of Telangana, the strike by employees in Road Transport Corporation of Telangana recently, and in immediate recently with regard to the corona pandemic. She sought information, arrangements, the measures that have been taken to contain corona pandemic from Health Minister and Chief Secretary themselves. And recently, Chief Minister of Telangana himself went to Raj Bhavan to convey the governor of the state with regard to the measures that have been taken to contain corona pandemic. What are they? We will look at these provisions. It is the duty of Chief Minister to convey the governor of important administrative and legislative decisions of the state. It is the duty of the Chief Minister to convey the governor of important administrative and legislative decisions of the state. Second, it is the duty of Chief Minister to furnish information required by the governor. This particular provision, Article 167, Provision 2, has been used in recent times by Telangana governor in many instances. This is what I've been just referring. Then Article 167 provision 3, if the governor asks so, it is the duty of the chief minister to lay the matter in front of council of ministers for its consideration. Here the matter refers to the matter on which the decision has already been taken, but it is not considered by council of ministers. Governor asks so, it is the duty of the chief minister to lay the matter on which the decision has already been taken, but it is not considered by council of ministers, to lay such matter in front of council of ministers for its consideration. Here, we need to understand, ours is parliamentary form of government, not presidential form of government. In presidential form of government, all the powers and functions of the executive are concentrated in a single hand, that is the office of the president. Entire executive functions are centered in a single office, that is the president. But on the other hand, in parliamentary form of government, the powers and functions of the executive, that is prime minister, have been percolated amongst his cabinet colleagues, the council of ministers. That's why constitutional experts term prime minister in parliamentary form of government as first among the equals. They term him as the first among the equals. The first among the equals. Why? They comment that the prime minister is first among the equals. The powers and functions of the executive have been percolated amongst the members of his cabinet or council of ministers. Hence, the important decisions are supposed to be taken by, whether it is prime minister or chief minister, consulting their respective council of ministers. In practice, their respective cabinets. And in case the executive takes important decisions without consulting his cabinet colleagues, the governor can ask the chief minister to lay such matter in front of council of ministers for its consideration. For instance, N. Kiran Kumar Reddy, the last chief minister of erstwhile United Andhra Pradesh, had taken many important administrative decisions which had tremendous ramification on administration of the state without consulting his cabinet colleagues. In such instances, the governor of the state can ask the chief minister to lay such decision in front of council of ministers for its consideration. In Article 175, the governor can address or send message to state legislature. Here, the way we drew the distinction between Article 86 and Article 87 with regard to the addresses that are delivered by the president, here also we need to make distinction. Under Article 176, the governor addresses the assembly and council in special circumstances, the way the president does at union level. What are these special circumstances? First, the first session after general elections. Second, the first session in new year. In these special circumstances, the governor addresses the assembly and council, legislative council. If the state legislature is to have second house. Here, special the governor addresses the assembly only in special circumstances. Second, such addresses are prepared by the Council of Ministers. He delivers such addresses on the advice of Council of Ministers. But on the other hand, the governor address under Article 175 is in his discretion. Is in his discretion. That is one. Second, under Article 175, the governor can address the assembly at any point of time, even if the assembly is not in its regular session, whether it is monsoon session or winter session or budget session. He can address the assembly at any point of time, not just in special circumstances. And first, what we discussed, address under Article 175 or the message under Article 175 will be in the pure discretion of the governor. Because of these two reasons, this particular article assumes significance. Apart from these two things, one more aspect we need to consider here, the governor can convey if he has any difference of opinion with Council of Ministers. The governor can convey his opinion or even if he has any difference of opinion with Council of Ministers, governor can convey to or legislative council or both. This is how Article 175 is of utmost importance. You may be having one question. What if the governor addresses both the houses of the legislature or state legislative assembly in case the state legislature has single house? Or even if he sends the message, what is the significance? What will happen? It will attract tremendous attention of media, which in turn attracts tremendous attention of general public. It attracts tremendous attention of media and public at large. Because of which, point that the governor wants to highlight will assume public significance. This is how this particular article is very important. That means, governor under Article 175 and the president under Article 86, they can punish the respective governments publicly with regard to government policies and programs and with regard to the effectiveness of and quality of functioning of the respective government. This is how these two articles assume significance at their respective levels. When we discussed the office of the president, time and again I mooted Article 86, which is one of the very important constitutional discretionary power of the president. Again, I repeat, never ever make mistake assuming that the president of India does not have any constitutional discretionary powers. He is just mere rubber stamp. No, he does have constitutional discretionary powers under Article 78, 86, 143. The giving assent or rejecting his assent to state bills that have been reserved by the governor. Then sixth schedule, according to sixth schedule, deal with the disputes between district autonomous councils and the state of Assam with regard to the royalties accruing from the mines that have been, what do you say, leased out. Here, my assistant made a mistake. To deal with the disputes between District Autonomous Council and State of Assam. It is State of Assam, not Governor. Autonomous District Councils and State of Assam with regard to royalties accruing from the mines that have been leased out. In Assam, in tribal areas, there are autonomous tribal district councils. They will be acting independently of state government. The way state government functions independently of central government in federal form of government. In the same way, autonomous district councils will be functioning independently of state government. They will be having their own powers and functions, and they will be having their own powers of taxation. These autonomous district councils share royalties with the state of Assam, state government of Assam. With regard to those mines fall within the ambit of that particular district autonomous council. So when any dispute arises between the government of Assam and particular district autonomous council, with regard to the share that ought to be distributed between the state government and the district autonomous council concerned, it is the governor who decides the dispute in his discretion, not on the advice of council of ministers. Then administration of tribal areas. Also, the governor function in his discretion. So these are the discretionary powers of the governor. With regard to these discretionary powers, the governor does not consult Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister of the State concerned. Doesn't act on the advice of Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister of the State concerned. It doesn't consult the Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister of the State Council. You always remember, these discretionary powers of the governor are very, very, very important for your prelims and mains. Most of the aspirants, they are committing this blunder. They are not learning the conventional concepts. They are in the misconception that current topics can be, what you say, prepared without having proper understanding of conventional concepts. No, the way you cannot build any big building without foundation, in the same way, you cannot adequately give or write answers to current-based questions without having adequate understanding of concepts. So be thorough with these facts and concepts, which are very, very pertinent for prelims directly and indirectly and directly for mains. In mains also, always remember, the UPSC is very shrewd. Always in my videos, I compare UPSC with the world-class pace bowler Wasim Akram. The way the batsman cannot predict the ball that is going to be bowled by Wasim Akram, in the same way, the tactics and maneuvers of UPSC, you cannot predict. 3 years, it poses questions on current issues. All of a sudden, it makes a swell. Sudden, what you say, curve. And it asks most of the questions which are based on facts. With my experience, I am telling you, I have prepared for this exam for 10 long years. I have taken prelims for 7 times, mains for 4 times. I know the tactics of UPSC. Please be careful. Don't be complacent with UPSC. UPSC, the U stands for Unpredictable Public Service Commission. The above instances that we have discussed, in which the governor will be having his discretion, where he does not act on the advice tendered by Council of Ministers. Now, the second half of the discretionary powers of the governor, the other part of the discretionary powers of the governor, what are they? In following instances, the governor consults the Council of Ministers headed by the Chief Minister, but ultimately he acts in his discretion. He consults Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister of the state concerned, but ultimately he acts in his discretion. Terminology, you should be very, what you say, careful, because this terminology and wording is very important in the examination hall, especially in prelims. That's where UPSC lays the catch. You may be trapped. Be careful with such terminology. So what are these instances where governor consults the Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister of the state concerned, but ultimately acts in his discretion? One by one we will discuss. Article 371, Provision 2, Provision A. The Constitution of Development Boards for Kutch and Saurashtra regions in Gujarat and Vidarbha and Marathwada regions in Maharashtra. Constitution of Development Boards for Kutch and Saurashtra regions in Gujarat, Vidarbha and Marathwada regions in Maharashtra. With regard to these functions, the governor consults the Council of Ministers headed by Chief Ministers of the states concerned, but ultimately acts in his discretion. Then Article 371, Capital Provision Capital A, 1B, with regard to land order administration in Nagaland, the governor has discretionary powers. He consults the Council of Ministers headed by Chief Minister concerned, but he acts in his discretion. Recently, the governor of Nagaland has used this provision, Article 371, Provision A, Provision 1 and Provision B, with regard to the deteriorating land order administration in Nagaland. He cautioned the state government. He sent the report to the center as well in this regard. With regard to the mafia and underworld that are operating in Nagaland. Then Article 371H, with regard to land order administration in Arunachal Pradesh. Then Article 371B, administration of tribal areas in Assam. Administration of tribal areas in Assam. Then Article 371, Provision C, Provision 1, Article 371, Provision C, Provision 1, the administration of hill areas in Madhya Pradesh. Then Article 371, F, Provision G, peace for peace, socio-economic development of all the sections of the state. With regard to above functions, the governor consults Council of Ministers headed by Chief Ministers of the respective states, but ultimately acts in his discretion. Now, is the office of governor still relevant? You may be having different opinion, I may be having different opinion. In the exam, we should be able to justify our answer. Why this question arises? Is the office of still relevant? Always be practical and don't be radical. With regard to any constitutional post which has constitutional sanctity, don't write criticism in berserk manner. Don't be berserk in criticizing constitutional offices and institutions. Of course, there may be instances in which some of these constitutional functionaries plumbered, and there may be some mistakes on the part of these constitutional functionaries, especially the governor of a state. In our 70 years of Indian independence experience and democratic experience, there are many instances the governors of the states acted in partisan manner. Then, our constitutional forefathers not predicted such kind of misutilization of governor's post, they might have. Still, they bestowed these many discretionary powers on the governor just for one main cause, is protect sovereignty and integrity of the nation. To protect the sovereignty and integrity of the nation. Before criticizing any constitutional functionary or any constitutional office, first you go through the history of democracy. How democracy originated in ancient Greek civilization, how it degenerated, what were the diabolical consequences of degeneration of democracy, where the representative government institutions took birth, how many long years have elapsed, transcend from monarchic and feudalistic rule to democratic rule in England. It took around 1288 years, around 1300 years they took to transcend from monarchic government to democratic government. How many years have we taken? In making of constitution, you will be reading 2 years, 11 months, 18. 2 years, 11 months, 18. Always you remember one thing, that whenever a society or a nation transcends from monarchic or feudal or colonial or aristocratic government to democratic government, many upheavals happen. For instance, in Britain, during 1300 years in which the British people fought tooth and nail with monarchic government, there were many instances of bloodshed. Kings were executed, people were killed. There were tussle between king on one hand, the great council and little council on the other hand, which were ultimately evolved into British power. If you see the history of US, immediately after getting independence from the Britishers, there were internal feuds amongst the states in USA. You will be wondered to know the southern states in United States of America, like you say South Carolina, they waged civil war to secede from the main union of USA. The original constitution of US was silent about whether a state can secede from the main union. But Supreme Court of US in 1869, in a case called Texas versus White, it ordered that no state of United States of America can secede from the main union. So there was civil war waged by the southern part of the US to secede from the main union. If you observe the democratic history of Western Europe, because of the immaturely developed democracies in Italy, in Germany, in France, have led to Second World War. Just in Germany, 6 lakhs people were massacred in gas chambers. These are the dire consequences when a particular nation or society transcends from monarchic or feudal or aristocratic government to democratic government. Now you just tell me, how many lakhs people died because of such upheavals in India when we transcended from colonial and monarchic and feudalistic rule to democratic rule within the short span of 2 years, 11 months and 18 days? Is because of the greatness of our constitutional forefathers who drafted our constitution as far as possible in foolproof manner. And this is one of the institutions of the constitution which protected the sovereignty and integrity of the nation. This office of governor, the gubernator at post. So never ever say that this post should be deleted or removed altogether, abolished altogether. Of course, there are some reforms ought to be, effected in this office to make the gubernatorial office more, impartial. But it is not constitutionally prudent to abolish the post altogether. That's why even first commission on center state relations, the Sarkaria commission, even the second commission on center state relations, M.M. Poonchi commission, never advocated for abolishment of this constitutional post. The recommendations that have been given by M.M. Poonchi Commission are very, very pertinent in this regard. Like, M.M. Poonchi Commission recommended that Article 163 should be amended so that the tremendous discretionary powers that have been given to the governor should be reduced. Then, the governor should be removed from the office only by impeachment motion voted by state legislative assembly concerned. The individual who is going to be appointed as governor should be apolitical. He should not have participated in political affairs at least in, recent 10 years. And post of governor should not be used as political football. This term of 5 years should not be disturbed in between, except for extraneous reasons. These recommendations are very, very pertinent. If you write these recommendations in the exam, if the examiner asks the question whether we should abolish the office of the governor altogether, suggest your recommendations. Then you can say, as MM Poonchi Commission says, these recommendations should be implemented with regard to the office of the governor to make this gubernatorial post apolitical and impartial. This constitutional office should not be abolished altogether in the light of the sovereignty and integrity of the nation. Because even in recent past, there are so many secessionist movements. And apart from that, Indian politics are characterized by centrifugal forces, such as regionalism. Regionalism is biggest menace in Indian politics. Now, the former Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh says, I will not allow the vehicles of Delhi to roam on the roads in Amaravati, the capital of Andhra Pradesh. Then whose vehicle will you allow? Chinese vehicle will you allow? Pakistani vehicles will you allow? American vehicles will you allow? This is the mindset of these regional parties, which are treating the state governments as their own feudal fiefdoms. They're assuming they are their feudal, jagir. They are, totally degenerating the local self-governing institutions, including municipal government, municipal institutions. Their, statements, the comments in public rallies, which are derogatory to the sovereignty and integrity of the nation. In the light of all these aspects, the governor's post should not be abolished altogether. Yet, as MM Poonchi Commission recommends, the reforms ought to be effected in this gubernatorial post to make this post more constitutional, to assume this post more constitutional sanctity and to make this post more apolitical and impartial. Thank you, friends. If you have any queries, doubts, please, you can share with this Telegram channel, polity_with_KiranAnishetty. Please use my promo code capital KIRAN and get 10% discount. Thank you. See you in the next session with more interesting and more important topics. Thank you. Thanks a lot.